Hey guys, Kevin here, and today I want to talk about Valyrian Steel in HBO's Game of Thrones and George R. R. Martin's A Song of Ice and Fire. Valyrian Steel is of a shade so gray that it is often considered black, and is frequently called as dark as smoke. It is much lighter than regular steel, and is distinguished by ripples, resulting from the steel being folded back on itself thousands of times. This, as well as other peculiarities during forging, give Valyrian Steel a natural strength. Valyrian steel is also much sharper than regular steel. The crown of the first Targaryen king, Aegon the Conqueror, was a Valyrian steel circlet studded with rubies. That crown was eventually lost by King Daeron I after the Tyrell he placed in charge of Dorne was killed by 100 red scorpions, and King Daeron himself was killed trying to reconquer Dorne. Valyrian steel is used in Maester's chains to signify the study of magic, although the purpose of that course of study in the Citadel is to convince maesters that magic doesn't work. Only one maester in 100 studies the so-called higher mysteries, and Maester Luwin of Winterfell was one such maester. Maester Luwin spends much of his time in the story telling the Green Seer, Warg, and future Three-Eyed Crow, Bran Stark, that magic simply doesn't work. Valyrian steel is also referred to as dragon steel, as confirmed by the show. Samuel Tarly reads in one of his books that the White Walkers can be slain by Dragonsteel, and in his last conversation with Lord Commander Jon Snow of the Night's Watch, they each suspect that Dragonsteel is indeed Valyrian Steel. Jon laughs at this misfortune, thinking that convincing the Lords of the Seven Kingdoms to give up their Valyrian Steel would be no harder than asking them to give up their coin and castles. Similarly, Tyrion Lannister remarks on his own father's fruitless attempts to buy Valyrian Steel from houses facing financial trouble. He was refused by every house, as such swords were cherished as family heirlooms. Only 227 Valyrian steel weapons were recorded to have been in the Seven Kingdoms, though now that number is technically 228, and some of those weapons, such as the Stark and Lannister swords, have been lost. Valyrian steel was produced in the Freehold of Valyria, and came to Westeros 200 years before the Doom, when Dragonstone was founded. Consequently, many of the Valyrian steel blades we see in the series are 500 years old, as the Targaryens ruled over Westeros for almost 300 years. In the show, we have been introduced to six Valyrian steel weapons, one of which was Littlefinger's dagger, which an assassin used to kill Bran early in season in Book 1. This same knife gave Catelyn Stark permanent scars on her hands as she fought the attacker to protect her son. The ancestral sword of House Stark for thousands of years has been known as ice. The ice at the beginning of the series is 400 years old, and is the first Valyrian steel sword that we are introduced to. Ice is a great sword, as wide as a man's hand, and taller than Robb Stark. Such a weapon is not very useful in battle, and Ned mainly uses it to execute men guilty of crimes punishable by death. After Ned Stark's death, Lord Tywin Lannister has ice melted down. Thus, there are only four Valyrian steel swords in the show. Three in the hands of the King of the North and his allies, and the other curiously lost. The Valyrian steel from ice is used to forge two new Valyrian weapons, one for King Joffrey named Widow's Wail, and the other for Sir Jaime Lannister named Oathkeeper. The two blades are uniquely colored, with Tyrion describing the ripples of the two swords as ripples of night and blood. Oathkeeper is half an inch wider, 3 inches longer, and has a much less ornate crossguard. Both swords have grips of red leather and gold lion's head pommels. Sir Jaime gives his sword to Brienne of Tarth, and orders her to find Sansa Stark and protect her. And in the show, Oathkeeper is used to protect the sister, or cousin, of the King of the North. The ancestral sword of House Tarly, Heartsbane, is 500 years old, making it one of the earliest Valyrian steel swords in Westeros. It is a two-handed greatsword and is wielded by Lord Randall Tarly, a respected military commander who famously defeated King Robert Baratheon at Ashford. As his eldest son, Samuel Tarly is the heir to the blade, but was sent away to the Night's Watch so that his younger brother Dickon can inherit. In the show, Samuel is now in possession of the sword. The last of the Valyrian steel swords in the show is the ancestral sword of House Mormont, Longclaw, which was once wielded by both Lord Commander Jorah Mormont of the Night's Watch and his son, Sir Jorah Mormont. Like Heartsbane, the sword is 500 years old, making it one of the first Valyrian steel swords in Westeros. Longclaw is a bastard sword, and had a bear-shaped pommel at the beginning of the series. The pommel was changed to a wolf's head after Jorah Mormont gifted it to Jon Snow for saving his life. So Longclaw is now the sword of the King in the North. In addition to the four remaining swords on the show, the book names 10 more Valyrian Steel swords and additional Valyrian Steel weapons and items. The ancestral sword of House Lannister, Brightroar, was lost by a King of the Rock named King Tommen while sailing to Valyria, a voyage from which he never returned. Tyrion Lannister's youngest brother, Jaehaerys, sailed to Valyria in search of Brightroar and also never returned. The Lannisters had gone centuries without a Valyrian steel sword until they beheaded Ned Stark. The Targaryens had two Valyrian steel swords, both of whereabouts unknown. The sister sword, Dark Sister, had a colorful list of owners, starting with Queen Visenya, one of the sister wives of Aegon the Conqueror. Prince Daemon Targaryen, husband of Queen Rhaenyra of the Dance of Dragon fame, and father of King Aegon III and King Viserys II. Viserys II's son, Aemon the Dragon Knight, also wielded Dark Sister, and the last known bearer of the sword was Brendan Rivers, also known as Bloodraven or the Three-Eyed Crow. The other Targaryen ancestral sword was Blackfyre. Its first known owner is Aegon the Conqueror, who, like Prince Rhaegar and his son Jon Snow, was a great warrior but took no pleasure in fighting. Blackfyre was also wielded by Maegor the Cruel and his rival King Jaehaerys I, Daeron I, who also wore Aegon's crown and famously conquered Dorne for a summer, and Daemon Blackfyre, the bastard son of Aegon IV, who led the Blackfyre Rebellion against his half-brother, King Daeron II, and whose children fought to overthrow the Targaryens for generations. The whereabouts of Blackfyre are unknown, but an early draft of an old released chapter suggested it may be with young Griff. The ancestral sword of House Royce was Lamentation, which was lost by Sir Willem Royce as he died defending the dragons in the Dragon Pit in King's Landing, from a mob during the Dance of Dragons. House Rhaegar is not a Westerosi house, as they hail from the Free City of Lee. Ballora Rhaegar was the mother of Aegon the Unworthy, Prince Aemon the Dragon Knight, and Queen Nereis. The Rhaegars once had a bank that rivaled the Iron Bank of Braavos, and their family sword was a Valyrian steel blade known as Truth. What happened to the blade and the family after their fall from power is unclear. The Valyrian steel sword of House Roxton, Orphan-maker, is last seen in the Dance of Dragons as Sir Jon Roxton is surrounded and cut down by Hardhugh's men. The ancestral sword of House Hightower of Old Town is Vigilance, and its whereabouts are currently unknown, though it is likely wielded by a Hightower in the present day. One of the three swords whose whereabouts we are certain of is in the Vale, and that is the ancestral sword of House Corbray, Lady Forlorn. The bearer of Lady Forlorn is Lynn Corbray, the younger brother of Lord Lionel Corbray, who switched sides during Robert's Rebellion and famously cut down the Kingsguard, Prince Lewin Martell, at the Trident. Sir Lynn is known for his bloodlust and is a loyal servant of Littlefinger, helping him weed out conspirators against him in the Vale. The other two Valyrian steel swords, whose whereabout we know of, are on the Iron Islands. The ancestral sword of House Drum is Red Rain. It is unclear how old Red Rain is, as House Drum paid the iron price for it, and we do not know which family had the sword before them. The sword was taken by Hilmar Drum after he defeated an armored knight with only his wits and a wooden cudgel. The other ironborn Valyrian steel sword is Nightfall, the ancestral sword of House Harlaw. The current bearer of Nightfall is Sir Horace Harlaw, who in his youth had been beaten many times by Lord Captain Victarion Greyjoy. House Harlaw is loyal to Theon's sister, and King Euron makes Sir Harris the Lord of Greyshield off the coast of the Reach to keep him too busy with the Tyrells and the Redwines to plot against him. The sword Nightfall has a moonstone pommel. The Valyrian house Keltigar of Claw Isle is known to have a Valyrian steel axe, and Kaegel Corpsekiller, the captain of the sellsword company of the Windblown, has a Valyrian steel eric, which is the preferred weapon of the Dothraki. Prince Quentin Martell states that such a weapon is rarer than Valyrian steel swords. The other Valyrian steel items we know of are all the possessions of King Euron Greyjoy. At the Kingsmoot, he gives away daggers of Valyrian steel, along with gold and ornate armor and weapons. Euron also introduces Dragonbinder at the Kingsmoot, a Valyrian steel horn, taller than a man, with Valyrian glyphs cut into the bands that girded it, and said to have the power to bind dragons to his will. In the release Winds of Winter chapter, The Forsaken, King Euron shows his brother, Dampair, his suit of Valyrian steel armor. The drowned priest Aaron Dampair comments that such a suit was rare even in the times of Valyria, saying that back then such a suit would cost a kingdom. Many fans predicted that we would see a suit of Valyrian steel, however, from a dream Jon Snow has in A Dance of Dragons. In the dream, Jon Snow is armored in black ice, fighting wights with a burning sword. This dream clearly depicts Jon Snow as Azor Ahai, and the armor of black ice is often interpreted as a suit of Valyrian steel, or the armor Prince Rhaegar wore at the Trident. Keep in mind that the first time we see Valyrian steel in the series is in a black sword as dark as smoke, named Ice. Anyway, Valyrian steel is a useful weapon, as it can be used to defeat the White Walkers, but the weapons are rare enough, and the enemies are likely too numerous to make a difference. So can more Valyrian steel be made? Well, there appears to be three key ingredients in making Valyrian steel. The first is magic spells. Valyrian steel is often referred to as spell forged, and only those who know the spells can make or even remake Valyrian steel. Fortunately, or not, the smiths of Kohor seem to know the magic spells necessary for reworking Valyrian steel, but cannot make new Valyrian steel, suggesting that there was a missing ingredient in Kohor for hundreds of years, and that missing ingredient was likely Dragonfire. In the first book, Daenerys refers to the Valyrian steel longsword she hopes to one day gift to Ser Jorah Mormont as Dragonforged. Similarly, Samuel Tarly reads that Valyrian steel was once referred to as Dragonsteel, stating that the last hero fought with the sword of Dragonsteel during the Long Night. Which brings us to the third ingredient, one that I mentioned in my Magic Part 2 video, and that is blood sacrifice. As stated earlier, the only smiths that can rework Valyrian steel are the smiths of Kohor, who know the magic spells and jealously guard their secrets. According to the World of Ice and Fire, Maester Pol was an example of how jealously the Kohoric smiths guarded their secrets. His hand was removed and he was exiled, with the official story being that he tried to steal a Valyrian steel blade. According to Maester Pol, however, he was punished for discovering that the smiths of Kohor used blood sacrifices to make their weapons. Since the Kohoric smiths are known to use blood sacrifice to make their swords strong, and the Kohoric smiths are the only ones capable of reworking Valyrian steel, it stands to reason that blood sacrifice is a necessary ingredient to reworking Valyrian steel, and likely an ingredient needed to make Valyrian steel in the first place. According to Samuel Tarly, the last hero who beat back the White Walkers during the Long Night fought with the blade of Dragonsteel, which would be the first documented Valyrian steel weapon. Readers are also told that the person who fought back the White Walkers during the Long Night was a hero named Azor Ahai, who fought with a flaming sword. The story of Azor Ahai depicts a man who spent a great deal of time forging his hero's sword. He likely spent that time folding the steel over itself hundreds and thousands of times, but the sword shattered when he tried to temper it in water. His second attempt likely saw even more foldings and an attempt to temper the steel in the heart of a lion, which again saw the sword shatter. His third and successful attempt saw him likely folding the steel even more than in the previous attempts, and using his wife, Nisa, as a blood sacrifice to temper the blade, creating Lightbringer by combining her soul with the steel of the sword. The darkness of this tale, and with all Valyrian steel, fits with all the other magic we can explain, as I state in Magic Part 2. These instruments of death appear to be forged from death themselves. Tyrion Lannister states in A Dance with Dragons that the Valyrians built an empire on blood and fire, and they reap what they sowed in the Doom. So yes, we seem to have all the ingredients necessary to make new Valyrian steel, but is it worth it?